President John F. Kennedy departed Washington on Thursday morning, November 21st, 1963. On Saturday morning, November 23rd, his body was returned to the White House. This is a filmed record of that two-day period. Went to Texas to take his program to the people. He had carried the state by only a narrow margin in the 1960 election. There was dissension there over his strong civil rights program. Ultra-conservative elements were critical, bitterly so, of the administration's foreign policy. And yet, the crowds that greeted the president and Mrs. Kennedy were friendly, enthusiastic. Newspapers described the trip as political. It was that, and it was more than that. Speaking at dedication ceremonies for the Aerospace Medical Health Center at Brooks Air Force Base, President Kennedy sought for unity amongst Americans. His conviction was, in his words, that the United States should be a leader.
More than 3 years, I've spoken about the new frontier. This is not a partisan term. And it's not the exclusive property of Republicans or Democrats. It refers instead to this nation's place in history, to the fact that we do stand on the edge of a great new era, filled with both crisis and opportunity, an era to be characterized by achievement and by challenge. It is an era which calls for action and for the best efforts of all those who would test the unknown and the uncertain in every phase of human endeavor. It is a time for pathfinders and pioneers.
Thursday afternoon, the presidential plane, Air Force One, departs San Antonio and touches down at Houston. Mrs. Kennedy is making one of her first public appearances in several months. Traveling with the presidential party are Vice President and Mrs. Johnson and Texas Governor John Connally. Thursday evening, Houston. President Kennedy speaks to the League of United Latin American Citizens. He speaks of his interest in the Alliance for Progress. He calls the Alliance a chance for all to prove that prosperity can be the handmaiden of freedom. Then, to ensure that his words will be understood by all, he calls on Mrs. Kennedy to address the League in Spanish. Thursday evening, the Houston Coliseum, a testimonial dinner for Congressman Albert Thomas.
in Texas and the nation. Change has been the law of life. Growth has meant new opportunities for this state. Progress has meant new achievements. And we dare not look back now. In 1990, the age of space will be entering its second phase. And our hopes in it to preserve the peace, to make sure that in this great new sea, as on Earth, the United States is second to none. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions, the Bible tells us. And where there is no vision, the people perish.
The presidential party moves on to Fort Worth, where the chief executive will spend the night and deliver several early morning speeches. A unique lighting display, normally seen on only two holidays a year, Fort Worth tribute to the president. Friday morning, November 22nd. It's 8:45 and the weather is misty. In spite of the weather, large and exuberant, tells his audience that Mrs. Kennedy is busy organizing herself, and adds, of course, she looks better than we do when she does it. Thus begins the last day of his life. He will live less than 4 hours from this moment. Governor John Conley applaud President Kennedy's entrance as he returns to his hotel for a breakfast with the Fort Worth Chamber of Commerce. The breakfast party awaits the arrival of Mrs. Kennedy. Kennedy's entrance draws another comment from the president.
2 years ago, I said that, introduced myself in Paris by saying that I was the man who had accompanied Mrs. Kennedy to Paris. I'm getting that same sensation as I travel around Texas. Nobody wonders what Lyndon and I wear.
On a more serious note, the president's last words, reflections of his hopes for the future.
This is a very dangerous and uncertain world. We would like to live as we once lived, but history will not permit it. The balance of power is still on the side of freedom. We are still the keystone and the arch of freedom, and I think we'll continue to do as we have done in our past, our duty. I'm confident, as I look to the future, that our chances for security, our chances for peace, are better than they've been in the past. And the reason is because we're stronger. And with that strength is a determination to not only maintain the peace, but also the vital interests of the United States.
Friday morning, 11 o'clock. The presidential jet leaves Fort Worth for the short flight to Dallas. where the president has a scheduled luncheon address. Friday morning, 11:37. The president's jet lands at the Dallas airport, Love Field. Several thousand enthusiastic Texans are on hand to give the president and Mrs. Kennedy a warm welcome. The usual welcoming committee presents Mrs. Kennedy with a bouquet of red roses. Although the president is running behind schedule, he pauses momentarily to shake a few hands. Mrs. Kennedy joins him in the throng of outstretched hands and cameras. Friday, 10 minutes before noon. The motorcade begins the 11-mile ride to the Dallas Trademark, where the president is to deliver a major address. Governor and Mrs. Connolly ride in the presidential limousine. In a downtown building, a gunman waits at a sixth-floor window, a high-powered rifle by his side. A radio newsman describes the motorcade as it moves toward the Dallas Trademark.
President's car is now turning onto Elm Street, and it will be only a matter of minutes before he arrives at the Trademark. I was on Simmons Freeway earlier, and even the freeway was jam-packed with spectators waiting their chance to see the president as he made his way toward the Trademark. It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route. There's numerous people running up the hill alongside Elm Street, there by the Simmons Freeway. Several police officers are rushing up the hill at this time. Stand by just a moment, please. Something has happened in the motorcade route. Stand by, please. Parkland Hospital, there has been a shooting. Parkland Hospital has been advised to stand by for a severe gunshot wound. I repeat, a shooting in the motorcade in the downtown area. Parkland Hospital has been advised to stand by for a severe gunshot wound. The president's car is now going past me. The limousine is now traveling at a very high rate of speed. Secret Service men standing up in the limousine. They are armed with submachine guns. It appears as though someone in the limousine might have been hit by the gunfire.
Put me on, Phil. Put me on. Phil, am I on? We're here at the Trademark. The motorcade is coming by here. I can see many, many motorcycles coming by now. Police motorcycles. Just heard a call on the radio for all units along Industrial to pick up the motorcade. Something has happened here. We understand there has been a shooting. The presidential car coming up now. We know it's the presidential car. You see Mrs. Kennedy's pink suit. There's a Secret Service man, spread eagle, over the top of the car. We understand Governor and Mrs. Connolly are in the car with President and Mrs. Kennedy. We can't see who has been hit, if anybody's been hit, but apparently something is wrong here. Something is terribly wrong. I'm in behind the motorcade, trying to follow them. It looks as though they're going to Parkland Hospital. We're on the road to Parkland at this time. Secret Service man is still spread eagle over whoever is in the car, the President and Mrs. Kennedy, and as we understand, Governor and Mrs. Connolly. At this point, it looks as though it could have been one or two or even all of the people within the car may have been the victims, may have been struck by shots. We don't know. Parkland Hospital in the distance. Now on Harry Hines Boulevard, following behind the motorcade, many, many police officers, maybe 20 or 25 motorcycle policemen, falling in behind at Trademark. A huge crowd left behind, waiting expectantly to see the president. The motorcade now perhaps two or three blocks ahead of me. They're approaching the entrance now to Parkland Hospital, traveling at a high rate of speed. Already police cars converging on Parkland from every angle, from every point. I'm pulling in now toward Parkland Hospital, coming to the approach. There's an officer waving me down. He's waving me around. There's a cordon. There's already a cordon of police officers running from their cars.
from their vehicles here. The official party, as I can see it, pulling around toward the emergency room of Parkwood Hospital. The policeman says, no, you cannot come in here. You cannot come in here. We'll let nobody else in. It was definitely the president's car. We could see the first lady's pink suit. That's the only identification we could see, but we know it is the president's car. Another car directly behind the presidential car. There were also parties in that car. Another Secret Service man, spread eagle over them. We don't know. Perhaps there was some hit in that car as well. We're not sure.
And just now, we've received reports here at Parkland that Governor Connolly was shot in the upper left chest, and the first unconfirmed reports say the president was hit in the head. That's an unconfirmed report that the president was hit in the head. The president's wife, Jackie Kennedy, was not hurt. She walked into the hospital at her husband's stretcher side. And a Dallas newsman, Val Couch, said he was riding shortly behind the president in the parade. He said after the shots were fired, he happened to look up at about the fifth or sixth floor of the Texas Book Depository. He said he saw the rifle being pulled back in.
President Kennedy has been given a blood transfusion at Parkland Hospital here in Dallas in an effort to save his life after he and Governor John Connolly of Texas were shot in an assassination attempt in downtown Dallas. A priest has been ordered, emergency supplies of blood also being rushed to the hospital.
Just a moment. We have a bulletin coming in. We now switch you directly to Parkland Hospital and KBOX News Director Bill Hampton.
The President of the United States is dead. I have just talked to Father Oscar Hubert of the Holy Trinity Catholic Church. He and another priest tell me that the pair of men have just administered the last rites of the Catholic Church to President Kennedy. President Kennedy has been assassinated. It's official now. The president is dead. Women here in shock, some fainted. Grown men, Secret Service men standing by the emergency room, tears streaming down their face. There's only one word to describe the picture here, and that's grief, and much of it. It's official. As of just a few moments ago, the President of the United States is dead.
At 1:33, a White House aide briefs newsman. Already, arrangements for swearing in the new president are being made. President Kennedy's body is to be placed aboard Air Force One for the flight back to Washington. At 2:38 in the forward cabin of Air Force One, a necessary ceremony.
I do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute
the office of President of the United States.
And will to the best of my ability.
Shortly before the dawn of Saturday morning, John Fitzgerald Kennedy comes home to the White House. He had been the nation's 35th president for a period of 2 years and 10 months.